Okay, the final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 1259 in the name of Clare Adamson on Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month 2021. The debate will be concluded without any questions put, and as usual, I would ask any members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or place an R in the chat function if they're joining us remotely. And I call on Clare Adamson to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Ms. Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I promise not to sing tonight. Can I start by paying tribute to the limitless dedication of the volunteers and campaigners that make Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month happen? Again, we're missing the sea of purple in our gallery, but I know that they are with us tonight. 2017 was the first time this debate was brought to the Parliament, and as I pause to reflect on what has changed, Presiding Officer, I can say that I have more speakers from my own benches than we had in that whole debate in 2017. And that is testament to the efforts of everyone who works to get pancreatic cancer in the political spotlight. And I genuinely thank every one of my colleagues across the chamber tonight who will take part in the debate, and I look forward to their contributions. Tonight, I want to talk about optimism. And that's not something we normally associate with this cancer. But first, let me outline some of the key statistics which show the need for action. Pancreatic cancer is the least survivable common cancer in Scotland. Only one in four people diagnosed with pancreatic cancer survive beyond a year. The five-year survival rate is only 5.6%. Just compare that to the five-year rate of 69% for other common types of cancer. And 7 in 10 people with pancreatic cancer will never receive any treatment. They will move straight to palliative care, and only 1 in 10 will receive surgery. Each November, we emphasise the importance of early diagnosis and intervention. Yet in Scotland, recent surveys show 55% of people know almost nothing about the disease, and 73% can't name a single symptom. So let's work to correct that. Symptoms to look for are abdominal pain that can spread to the back, unexplained weight loss and loss of appetite, new diabetes without weight gain, a yellowing of the skin or the eyes and itchy, and a change in bowel habits, including indigestion that doesn't respond to treatment, or smelly peel or floating stools. Figures around pancreatic cancer have remained static for 50 years. I've said that in every debate we've had since 2017, but do we really take what that means on board? I was recently reading about Succession star and National Treasure Brian Cox, who I met in this Parliament at an event. His autobiography, he talks about his being pushed into acting largely because of the trauma he had felt after his father, Charlie, passed away from pancreatic cancer just 3 weeks after his diagnosis. And when we think of the span of Brian Cox's life and career and that body of work, and then his experience, devastating as it was, is so redolent of the many patients and families experiencing the diagnosis of pancreatic cancer and those who have shared it with me. And today in Scotland, 50 years after his family experienced this, another family could be hearing the same devastating news and face losing a loved one within a matter of weeks. And that's why we're all here tonight. So what about that case for optimism? Where can we look for change? And we must remember that with earlier diagnosis, pancreatic cancer can be survived. For those diagnosed in time for potentially life-saving surgery, a five-year survival increases to around 30%. Early diagnosis, intervention, and holistic care can mean people can live longer and enjoy a better quality of life. And there are initiatives across the country working to raise awareness of this disease. In the summer, I was pleased to take part in the Big Step Forward, and wearing my medal today, organised by Pancreatic Cancer. And I had a walk around Strathclyde Park, accompanied by Kim Rowan, who's a formidable campaigner on this area, Dawn from Pancreatic Cancer, and Julia Stachuska, my assistant, and Mulak the dog. And I have to say, if you want to raise awareness of an issue, you can wear all the t-shirts you want in the world. If you take a dog on a walk with you, you're going to get people asking what's happening. Thousands of people took part in this initiative. An amazing £248,786 was raised for world-leading research into pancreatic cancer. I also attended the fabulous production of Islets of Silence, The C Word, a play written and directed by Isabel Barrett, and it was heartwarming, difficult, but laced with purpose and hope. Most importantly, with the help of Pancreatic Cancer Action Scotland, the play is taking awareness right into our local communities. And they are also hosting, outside the Parliament, the PanCan van, which takes the message about pancreatic cancer awareness into our communities. They go to events, they go into our town centres and explain to people about how to look out for the symptoms of this cancer. They're here tomorrow outside the Parliament. I encourage all my colleagues to visit the PanCan van. I also must mention the indomitable Linda Murray, whose advocacy for this cause cannot be overstated. The death of her father, William Begley, has inspired us to campaign relentlessly for a patient pathway that will give people a chance her father didn't have. And this summer, she linked me in with the SHPBN, Hepatocellular Carcinoma and Pancreatic Cancer Patient Pathways Improvement Project. So wish me luck with this. I'm going to have to say that again. So the Scottish Hepatopancreatobiliary Network aims to ensure equity in care for patients throughout Scotland with cancer of liver, pancreas, gallbladder and biliary tree. The Scottish Government has awarded funding of £653,000 to this new SHPBN project to help streamline and shorten the staging phase and simultaneously enhance patient care and support through communication. And I thank all of the clinicians involved in this, and pay particular mention to Ross Carter and Anya Adair for their work. Now, despite the grim statistics we encounter, there is a well of innovation around pancreatic cancer. And I know we're really busy tonight, Presiding Officer. I could go on about the precision panc areas, but I know from the people who are in the chamber this evening that these areas will be covered by my colleagues. A final ask to the Minister this evening is to look at the stereotactic ablative radiotherapy, SABR, for treating locally advanced pancreatic care that's being piloted in England at the moment, and ask that the government have a look with interest to the success of that project as another way of fighting this cancer. So continued investment, training, research and cultural shifts to holistic care are vital if we're to overcome pancreatic cancer, and I hope that one day this annual debate will not need to take place and people and families affected by pancreatic cancer can look back to this as a time of change. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Adamson. I know what you mean about taking the dog for a walk. I've got one of those. He just decides he doesn't want to come back home with me all of the time. So anyway, we'll move on to the open debate. I'll call first Jenny Minto, to be followed by Sue Webber. Ms Minto, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The pancreatic cancer ribbon is purple. It represents the love of one daughter for her mother. Rose Schneider died after battling pancreatic cancer. Her daughter founded the Pancreatic Cancer Network to support those affected. Purple was Rose's favourite colour. Tomorrow evening, as part of World Pancreatic Cancer Day, Dunoon landmarks will be bathed in purple light, reflecting the love of a family and a community for one of their own, local firefighter David Cahoon. David was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer in September this year. I would like to thank my colleague Clare Adamson on behalf of David and his family for ensuring that the Scottish Parliament plays its important role in raising people's awareness of pancreatic cancer. His sister-in-law, Jacqueline Kennedy, said to me yesterday, All cancers need to be up there. We need people to talk about them. As Clare has said, pancreatic cancer is the deadliest common cancer in Scotland. The five-year annual survival rate is only 5.6%. Awareness levels in Scotland are low. 55% of people know almost nothing about the disease. Jacqueline is right. We need to talk about it. David is Dunoon through and through. He has his own roofing business as is employed as a firefighter at Dunoon Fire and Rescue Service. In August this year, David was one of the heroic firefighters who risked his own life during the horrific fire in Argyle Street. David has given so much to his community. Tomorrow, his community will be showing their support for him and helping raise awareness of the key symptoms of pancreatic cancer. The family wanted to use what they were experiencing to improve the prospects of others. By bringing their voices, commitment and energy, they are helping change the pancreatic story across Cowell. David's daughter and her friends organised a sponsor Wear Purple Day at Dunoon Grammar School. Friends and family have taken on individual walking challenges, all raising funds for Pancreatic Cancer Action Scotland and Pancreatic Cancer UK. And tomorrow evening there will be a walk through the town, visiting all the purple lit landmarks from Dunoon Fire Station to Dunoon Castle House Museum. This has been an incredibly tough couple of months as David, his wife, his children, immediate family and friends come to terms with the diagnosis, but the support they have received from NHS Scotland, as well as Sheila, their amazing Macmillan cancer support nurse, have been a huge help. Both Pancreatic Cancer UK and Pancreatic Action have also been great. Both charities work tirelessly for people living with and affected by pancreatic cancer, supporting innovative research to find breakthroughs that will help how pancreatic cancer is understood, diagnosed and treated. One example of this is PERT, pancreatic enzyme replacement therapy, a tablet which replaces the digestive enzymes that people with pancreatic cancer can no longer produce. Only one in three people with pancreatic cancer in Scotland are being prescribed PERT, but fortunately Scotland is acting on this issue and leading the way in transforming PERT prescription rates. Presiding Officer, I will finish with the simple and honest words from Jacqueline, which ring true for any illness, but even more so for pancreatic cancer, as it does not present in an obvious way. Jacqueline said to me, "Keep listening to your body and keep going to the doctor." Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chief Minto. And I call Sue Webber, who will be followed by Marie McNair. Again, 4 minutes, Ms. Webber.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. November is Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month, and tomorrow, Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Day. And I really welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate to show my support. It's a fantastic chance for the pancreatic cancer community to come together, to raise awareness, funds, and to remember loved ones who have sadly died of this disease. Raising awareness is key because two-thirds of people in the UK cannot name a single symptom of pancreatic cancer. Even more worrying is that around half of pancreatic cancer patients will visit their GP with their symptoms three times before being referred to the hospital. Pancreatic cancer is the deadliest common cancer in Scotland, and only one in four people diagnosed survive beyond a year. 10,000 people across the UK are diagnosed each year. Yet pancreatic cancer receives only 2% of the national cancer research funding, despite being the fifth highest killing cancer. Scotland is leading the way, as we've heard, in many pancreatic cancer innovations. For example, the Precision Panc is a major research programme being developed and run out of Glasgow at the Beatson. It collaborates with world leaders from the University of Glasgow, the Cancer Research UK Beatson Institute, Cancer Research UK Cambridge, Manchester, and the Institute of Cancer Research in London, the University of Oxford, and the NHS. My life before this chamber allowed me unparalleled access to the surgical treatment of this deadly cancer. Working alongside upper GI consultants across the country, Ross Carter, as you've already mentioned, Clare, I know firsthand of the complex nature of the surgery needed to treat this pancreatic cancer. These are very much specialist surgeons that have dedicated and committed to adopting innovations to reduce surgical operative time, even by the slightest margins, and to seeking new ways to reduce surgical risk and post-operative complications. They work collaboratively across the NHS to do all they can to ultimately increase the survival of their patients. But the outcomes following this potentially life-saving surgery are still a long way from being acceptable. If diagnosed in time for surgery, the 5-year survival increases to 30%. So in short, we need to diagnose people far earlier. And if people can be diagnosed earlier, they will live longer and experience a far better quality of life. If you do face a diagnosis of pancreatic cancer, as my friend's mother has, life stops, albeit briefly, and your family and friends must respond quickly. Mike had to come all the way back from Australia, and the only saving grace is that he was able to return to see his mum, because 1 year ago, he would not have been able to do that. Such a diagnosis of pancreatic cancer can affect every aspect of life, bringing emotional, financial and practical problems that can last long after treatment ends. So if you are in this position and are listening to this debate today, can I take this chance to direct you to the practical, emotional and financial support that's offered by Macmillan Cancer? As a first step, they have a telephone helpline and it's 0808 808 0000, or please go to their website for help. And finally, I'd want to turn to Clare Adamson for bringing this debate before Parliament today and thanking her for helping to raise the awareness of pancreatic cancer.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Webber. I now call Marie McNair, who will be followed by Carol Mochen. 4 minutes, please, Ms McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin my contribution by congratulating Clare Adamson for securing this debate? I know she has a long-standing interest in this issue. I commend her initiative and her opening speech. It was a contribution made with compassion and real understanding of the issues. It is really important that we take this opportunity to not only recognise Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month, but that we also strive to improve the response to this dreadful disease. For me, I will also use this debate to ensure the voices of my constituents impacted by pancreatic cancer are heard in this chamber. As we know, this is the 10th anniversary of Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month, with Thursday being marked as World Pancreatic Cancer Day. Over 9,000 people die of this disease annually across the UK, and this is often tragically within weeks of diagnosis. We need to raise awareness to save lives. We know that the public awareness levels are really low. 52% of the public know almost nothing about the disease, and 73% can't name a single symptom. It is the lowest survival rate of all the cancers, mainly due to late diagnosis. My constituent, Kayleigh Martin, contacted me asking if I'd raise awareness of pancreatic cancer. It is an honour to do so on her behalf in this chamber today. Kayleigh lost her mum, Helen Carson, in December of 2020 to this disease, only 3 months after diagnosis. Helen worked at the STEC for 40 years, a job that she enjoyed very much. She was also a very proud Bankie, born and bred. Kayleigh is pushing for better treatment nearer to people's homes and increased awareness of the disease. She feels that the general public and health practitioners alike need to be more aware of the signs and symptoms of pancreatic cancer to enable a quicker diagnosis. Also, her experiences have convinced her of the need for enhanced end-of-life care and support. Better communication and streamlined services are essential to help those impacted to enable them to use the time they have left to greater effect. Helen attended the Victoria Hospital and the Glasgow Royal Infirmary for further investigations, which left her exhausted and fatigued. As Helen's disease was found to be so far advanced, treatment with chemotherapy was not an option. Helen felt that if this information was been available sooner, it may have allowed her to spend more precious time with her family. Another of my constituents, Kirstine Smiley, also wants more awareness of this terrible disease, to which she lost her father, Donald Langan. Kirstine's dad, Donald, had a bit longer with his family. He lived for a year and a half from first being diagnosed. During these final months, he had chemotherapy prior to extensive surgery, during which a number of his major organs were removed. Unfortunately, when the cancer returned to his lungs, he sadly only lived for a further 9 days. Kirstine and her mum, Christine, Donald's beloved wife, and her family continue to fundraise to help raise awareness and continue research into this terrible disease. They're currently taking part in Pancreatic Cancer UK's 10,000 steps a day throughout November. I wish her and all the family the very best in their endeavours. These are real, heartbreaking, real-life experiences from some of my constituents that highlight how important early diagnosis is. We must ensure that compassionate care and support is there when people need it. As a member of the nursing team at the St Margaret of Scotland Hospice, I saw firsthand how quickly patients deteriorated and died from this cancer. Unfortunately, late diagnosis resulted in palliative and end-of-life care being the patient's only options. Again, I'll never forget the impact that this cancer had on families whose love, compassion and support was unwavering and selfless. This is reflected and recognised in the testimony I've given on behalf of my constituents. So I welcome this debate and everything else that's been done to promote the importance of early diagnosis. I'm humbled by the determination of my constituents to see more action on this front. In memory of those who have lost their lives to this terrible disease, we must collectively work together to do all we can to increase awareness of this cancer and aim for more positive outcomes. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms McNair. I now call on Carol Mochan, who will be followed by Evelyn Tweed at 4 minutes, please, Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Clare Adamson for bringing this important debate to the Chamber. And on behalf of Scottish Labour, I am really proud to highlight the importance of Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month and indeed the importance of marking World Pancreatic Cancer Day tomorrow. Pancreatic cancer truly is one of the most aggressive cancers, and sadly, it is perhaps the deadliest common cancer in our country. It's one that often brings an abrupt end to life of those that it targets. In my own local health board of Ayrshire and Arran, it has killed between 50 and 70 people every single year for the last decade. That's 50 to 70 families devastated year after year. A close family friend died from this many years ago, and I'm sure today he will be thought of by so many people, and certainly with some very fond memories from my own parents and family. The COVID-19 pandemic has impacted our lives in many ways, but one of the most concerning impacts has been the reduction in cancer diagnosis at an early stage. Staff shortages, pressure on the NHS, long GP waiting times, amongst a host of other factors, have contributed to figures which Cancer Research UK call devastating. Admittedly, the context of a global pandemic has impacted the ability of health services across the world, but in Scotland, we have to act with purpose to reverse these concerns, resume early detection and give those who have cancer the best chance of life. However, it is absolutely devastating that even after diagnosis and treatment, many of those diagnosed with pancreatic cancer are not given that chance of life due to symptoms not being noticed or treated with concern until too late a stage. Therefore, Deputy Presiding Officer, I think it is important to highlight a further time that key symptoms of pancreatic cancer include abdominal or back pain, discomfort, unexplained weight loss or a loss of appetite, yellowing of the skin or eyes or itchy skin, a change in bowel habits, nausea or vomiting, and indigestion that does not respond to treatment. Just as importantly, I think it has to be made very clear to the public that even though under strain and still, you know, staff shortages, the NHS is open and accessible. And if a member of public has concerns, it is better to have a medical examination than wait until it is too late. The importance of public awareness of symptoms and indeed public awareness that treatment or examination is available to them should they need it cannot be understated. And I think we would all agree in the chamber, if you are concerned, you should go forward. As Clare Adamson rightly mentions in her motion, despite some recent progress, the survival rates for pancreatic cancer have been stubbornly similar for far too long. And it's incumbent on all of us now to do more, to act and to raise further awareness of this awful disease, to help secure the early diagnosis and treatment that can be so vitally important to someone's future. However, I would again, as I often do, bring to the attention of this chamber the health inequalities that underpin survival for cancer. It is again the case in Scotland, according to Public Health Scotland, that increasing areas of deprivation linked to poorer survival rates for cancer, and we must strive to do something about it. It is unjust and unfair in 2021 Scotland that this remains the case, and much more work needs to be done to address these clear health, social and economic inequalities. That means a person's postcode can come between a stronger or weaker chance of survival from a deadly disease. I would like to take time to thank those organisers that have done so much work to raise awareness of pancreatic cancer, as mentioned by many members. Their work cannot be understated or undervalued, and as parliamentarians, we must do all we can to support them. As we hope to continue our progress from the COVID-19 pandemic, the Scottish Government needs to ensure its priorities lie with addressing late diagnosis and focus on early intervention. And indeed, it must do more to tackle the widespread health inequalities which to this day remain a stain in our society and adversely impact those from the most deprived areas. Once again, I would like to wish all those involved in Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month the very best and thank Clare. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Mochan. Before I call Evelyn Tweed, I'm conscious of the number of members that still want to contribute to the debate, so I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes, and I would invite Clare Adamson to move such a motion.
Moved. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? Yes. Excellent. Right. With that, we move on. Evelyn Tweed, who will be followed by Miles Briggs. 4 minutes, Ms Tweed.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I am grateful to Clare Adamson for bringing this very important debate forward tonight to highlight Pancreatic Awareness Month and to Pancreatic Cancer UK for the briefing. The last 18 months has, of course, seen the world thrown into an unprecedented public health crisis. As a result, there has been less focus on other illnesses and diseases. As other speakers have noted, sadly, the statistics show that even without the additional strain on health services across the UK, pancreatic cancer is one of the deadliest and the hardest to detect. It clearly requires more attention. A main problem with this cancer is that it is difficult to diagnose. Even short delays between diagnosis and having surgery or chemotherapy drastically lower the chances of survival. According to the NHS Scotland Inform website, in the early stages, a tumour in the pancreas doesn't usually cause any symptoms. And the first noticeable symptoms, such as back or stomach pains that come and go, or unexplained weight loss, can be caused by many different conditions. As a result, people commonly attend 3 or more GP appointments before hospital referral, and so many are diagnosed through emergency presentation, leading to very poor outcomes. Nearly 1,000 people per year are diagnosed with pancreatic cancer in Scotland, with around 50 of those residing in Forth Valley. In January, Stirling University student Keir Morton helped raise thousands of pounds for pancreatic cancer research in memory of his dad, who died just over 2 weeks after diagnosis. And in July, Jennifer Berner from Stirling also raised money for pancreatic cancer research after her mum died, again, less than 2 weeks after diagnosis. She had shown no symptoms at all other than exhaustion and loss of appetite. Our NHS does an incredible job in oncology, and of course, the support of Macmillan and cancer research is amazing. But there is so much more to do. We need to raise awareness of the use of pancreatic enzyme replacement therapy, or PERT for short, with health professionals, which could help people deal with this cancer. And education is key here. We know that dedicated research and awareness campaigns drove up early diagnosis of breast cancer. It has gone from being one of the most lethal cancers to one of the most treatable and survivable. A similar focus is now required on pancreatic cancer. The message is clear: early detection and treatment is essential. I welcome the Scottish Government's action plan for cancer services. Additional funding for our health boards will support better access to diagnostics and treatment, and the creation of early cancer diagnostic centres is a significant step forward. Patient pathways through cancer services help define a patient's overall experience and access to treatment and potentially their outcomes. I therefore look forward to hearing of a successful redesign of the pancreatic cancer pathway. As we know, Scotland's general health, including cancer rates, are the result of decades of structural inequality that the Scottish Government continues to tackle, and we cannot be complacent. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Tweed. I now call Miles Briggs, will be followed by Gillian Martin. 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I also start by congratulating Clare Adamson on again securing this evening's members' debate, and also for all her campaigning, which she's done with distinction, really, over many years now in this Parliament on this issue. And as the co-convener of the Parliament's cross-party group on cancer, I'm pleased to be able to take part again in this year's debate, as I have along with Clare every single year. I look forward to seeing lots of purple displayed across landmarks across our country, and especially on social media, which I think has become even a bigger hit as we aim to increase knowledge and understanding of this cancer. As with all cancers, early detection and intervention is critical. The 5-year survival rate, as members have touched upon, for pancreatic cancer is as low as just 5.6% still. And for many, for other more survivable cancers, as Evelyn Tweed has already pointed out, the average 5-year survival rate is nearly 69%. Now, arguably, early detection of pancreatic cancer is even more critical than other cancers, with a 5-year survival rate increasing to around 30% of those diagnosed earlier and those able to access life-saving surgery. It is of huge concern that 80% of people with pancreatic cancer are not still diagnosed until that cancer has developed and advanced to an advanced stage. Now, tomorrow is World Pancreatic Cancer Day, and the theme this year is It's About Time. Improving awareness about the risks and symptoms of pancreatic cancer is crucial, and it's important that we all work to make sure that we do improve these survival rates. Now, I commend Pancreatic Cancer Action Scotland on their mission of making the 2020s the decade of change for pancreatic cancer. I think that's something we can all sign up to and all want to see. Over the last 50 years, there's been a lack of significant improvement in survival rates, and we need that concerted effort to really ensure that more people can be diagnosed early and survive the disease. The last year and a half has been dominated by COVID-19, and the shift which has focused our National Health Service on treating people for that virus has seen the public health messaging shift away from encouraging people to actually come forward and present with their concerns. Now, I think we all share the concern that that is going to impact on cancer outcomes across all cancers. Recent research by Pancreatic Cancer UK revealed that 31% of Scots are saying that they are delaying seeking help for treatment. That's something we need to turn around and make sure the message is sent out, that people shouldn't be delaying taking these concerns to their GP and medical professionals. Of those less likely to seek help, around half, 49%, said they didn't want to be a burden on the NHS, while a quarter, 24%, said they were still concerned about contracting COVID-19. So making people aware that our NHS is up and running and wants people to present is so important. I hope this debate really sends that message this evening as well, that people should be getting checked out if they're exhibiting any of the symptoms which other members have outlined. It's clear we do have a long way to go to improve survival rates. That's something I don't think in all the debates have taken place. Sadly, we haven't seen that 5% get to 10%, to 15%, to 20%. So I would like, if the Minister is closing the debate tonight, in pointing out where actually work is going to be taken forward to help review patient pathways, because I think that's one of the key things we all want to see looked at specifically, especially post-pandemic. But I do want to take this opportunity as well to thank all those who have supported and campaigned over many years to support the work of Pancreatic Cancer UK. Kim Rare and my constituent, the wonderful Linda Murray, all these people have done so much work. Sadly, they can't be in the Parliament yet next year. I'm sure they will be. And that, I think, is our hope as well. Because Clare Adamson did start by talking about hope. And I think that's really important. For me, the person who really personifies that is our former MSP colleague, John Scott. John is well and living a happy post-politics life to the full. And I think those examples of people who have fought pancreatic cancer are really important for so many people and families who are facing the hell of a pancreatic cancer diagnosis. I hope today's debate, to conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, does once again give us the opportunity to highlight the great work of Pancreatic Cancer UK and the Awareness Month's principles and work. There is much progress that needs to be made in the years ahead, and I hope MSPs from all parties across the Chamber will continue to speak out and keep pressure on ministers. But above all, I agree with what Clare Adamson laid out. There is hope, and we should all work towards a better future on that. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Briggs. I would ask you to convey our best wishes to John Scott. That is indeed good news. I call Gillian Martin, who will be followed by Sandra Scolhani. 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to thank Clare Adamson for, I think it's our fifth consecutive year in securing this debate on Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month. And that dedication that she shows to this cause helps us have a platform to raise awareness of this terrible disease and its impact on those who suffer from it and on their loved ones. And I'm always very aware that when we read out statistics on pancreatic cancer, any cancer, but particularly this one, that we'll have people watching the debate who maybe just received a diagnosis or they're in treatment or they're close to someone who is. And mentioning the survival rates of this disease is really difficult to hear. And those with that diagnosis will be only too aware of what their diagnosis could mean for them. But for the reality of those rates makes it particularly important that we have this regular debate and we shine a light and we use the platform that we have on how we catch this disease early. And I didn't speak in last year's debate, but I sat and listened to every contribution, and it was particularly poignant because John Scott was back in the chamber and he was looking a lot better, and it's great to hear that he's continuing to do well, because that does give us hope. This is a cancer that people can survive. Clare Adamson also talked about the vital research and clinical trial work. It was last year's debate at universities to improve future treatments and outcomes. And in particular, Glasgow University partnering with the Precision Panc platform, working with the Beatson Hospital and other partner universities across the UK. And this research is investigating the molecular profile of individuals with pancreatic cancer and is bringing that expertise from 20 UK hospitals offering clinical trials together. And these precision medical clinical trials use the genomics of the patient and their tumour, and they're offering hope for that 85% of pancreatic cancer patients who are not eligible for surgery. And maybe we could get to the future that Clare Adamson described, where we don't have the statistics that we do now on it. As everyone has said, early diagnosis of pancreatic cancer is literally vital. And for those diagnosed in time for surgery, that 5-year survival rate does increase by 30%. And I applaud the awareness-raising campaigns of Pancreatic Cancer Action Scotland. And of course, I'll be sharing their material as widely as I can. And it's important for us as MSPs to use our platforms to help our constituents know those early symptoms. So that's how I'm going to end my contribution, because, you know, people do watch those videos that we put up on social media. So let's use the platforms to tell people what the symptoms are. So get yourself to the GP if you've any of these symptoms. If your back or stomach hurts, could be a tumour that's pushing against nerves or organs near the pancreas and blocking your digestive tract. And similarly, if you feel bloated, get it checked. Pancreatic cancer can cause digestive problems like gas and bloating and a build-up of extra fluid in the abdomen. Loss of appetite, indigestion, nausea, and constipation or diarrhoea.
And if you're losing weight and you don't know why, it could be because cancer is causing your body to burn more calories than usual and breaking down your muscle and decreasing your appetite. And if your skin or eyes look yellow, it could be jaundice caused by a tumour blocking the bile duct, which should ordinarily be allowing bile to flow from your gallbladder into the small intestine. So these are all things that you need to be aware of. Don't, as Miles Briggs has says, don't think that you shouldn't be going to see your doctor because we're in a pandemic. These are all signals that something could be wrong. Hopefully there isn't anything wrong, but you must get it checked out. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Martin. And I call Sandra Sweet Gulhani, who will be followed by Emma Harper. Dr Gulhani, 4 minutes, please.
I thank Clare Adamson for securing today's important debate and commend her for consistent campaigning on pancreatic cancer. Pancreatic cancer is Scotland's deadliest common cancer, as we have been hearing, and just under 1,000 people in Scotland are diagnosed with pancreatic cancer each year, with 10,000 across the UK. Despite only being the 12th most common cancer in Scotland, pancreatic cancer is responsible for the 6th highest number of cancer deaths. A significant disproportionate impact. As you may know, I still am a practising NHS GP, and I see firsthand the truly devastating impact that pancreatic cancer has on patients and their families. A significant issue is that this disease symptoms are not widely known, but as we've just heard from Gillian Martin and from people around the chamber tonight, I'm hoping people that are listening and watching are able to understand those symptoms, and I won't repeat them again. According to Pancreatic Cancer UK, 2/3 of people in the UK cannot name a single symptom. And as a result of this, 20% of people with pancreatic cancer are diagnosed at an early stage. And 7 in 10 people will never receive the treatment at all. Tragically, 80% of people are diagnosed when the cancer is advanced and too far for life-saving treatment. And unfortunately, there are no screening or early detection tests that we can do to try and diagnose this in advance. When I recently met with Pancreatic Cancer UK, the focus of our meeting was support, because when you're diagnosed with a cancer that kills 1 in 4 patients within a month, you need all the support you can get. But currently there are too many missed opportunities to provide emotional support that's needed. And at key moments, diagnosis, beginning and end of treatment, before and after surgery, patients are really vulnerable and they need help because they struggle with their mental health. Discovering the poor survival statistics for pancreatic cancer is a difficult moment for any patient, and one through which people need to be effectively and thoroughly supported with specialist mental health support. In my view, the most experienced people outside of those in the NHS to speak with is Pancreatic Cancer UK, which has a dedicated helpline, which Sue Webber has already read out. And they're staffed by specialist pancreatic nurses who provide expert support with symptoms, medication, and anything in between, as well as a much-needed listening ear. And that's why I want to ensure that everyone with a diagnosis of pancreatic cancer is immediately signposted to Pancreatic Cancer UK support line. And currently, only 10% of people diagnosed with pancreatic cancer in Scotland currently access this free service. It's my mission today, and it should be our mission over the coming year, to drive up awareness of this service so that everyone with a diagnosis or even just a suspicion of pancreatic cancer gets the support they need from day one. We need to reach that remaining 90%. I want to see signposting to Pancreatic Cancer UK support line included as default in all communication shared with those who are diagnosed. But I want to go further. When people are diagnosed with cancer, any cancer, I propose they are linked with the appropriate leading third sector organisation. Now, this could be Macmillan Cancer Support, Bowel Cancer UK, Pancreatic Cancer UK, or other specialist services. I'd like to see all patients with cancer get the appropriate third party sector agency number, website, and telephone number and a leaflet in the diagnosis letter that they get. I'd like to see that given to them in the surgery when they're with their doctor. This enables vulnerable patients to get wraparound support straight away and the specialist support that they need, and can be given the time to speak by the nurses that man a lot of these telephone numbers. Minister, please could you take this suggestion and try to implement it, because it would be a very cheap way of us getting help. And I'd like to give apologies to the Chamber for having to leave early, but I must attend a Diwali event here hosted in Parliament. But I felt it was very important to speak here. I was compelled to do so, despite not being one of the Conservative members down to speak tonight.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gulhani. I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Siobhan Brown. Again, 4 minutes, Ms. Harper.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this important debate ahead of World Pancreatic Cancer Day on 18th of November, which is tomorrow, and congratulate Clare Adamson, who's sitting right in front of me, for securing it. Clare has done a huge amount of work to raise awareness of pancreatic cancer and has led this debate each year since 2017. I'm also glad that Miles Briggs and Julian Martin have mentioned former MSP John Scott. It is good to hear how well he's doing. And I want to thank all the clinicians and all the staff caring for people with pancreatic cancer, and I remind the Chamber that I am still a nurse. Many of these folks are my former colleagues. It is worth noting that the COVID pandemic has created many additional challenges for cancer services across Scotland, and I agree with Pancreatic Cancer Action Scotland that increasing awareness, encouraging awareness of symptoms earlier, and improving pathways to diagnosis, support and information and care is more important than ever before. Presiding Officer, of colleagues across Chamber have stated pancreatic cancer is currently the deadliest common cancer in Scotland, with statistics indicating that 800 people die each year in Scotland within just 2 weeks of diagnosis. That's a pretty stark statistic. And the Scottish Government have invested in research, recognition of the disease and less survivable cancers in the current Recovery and Redesign Action Plan for Cancer Services. And the announcement of £653,000 funding to support the Scottish Hepato-Pancreato-Biliary Network Improving Pancreatic Cancer Pathways project is extremely welcome. One example of research which I would like to focus my comments on, which Gillian Martin has already touched on as well, is the Precision Panc platform. I spoke about this last year too. Not all pancreatic cancers are the same, Presiding Officers. Precision Panc clinical trials are delivered through the NHS, and they match people who have a diagnosis of pancreatic cancer to the clinical trial most likely to work for them. Precision medicine is about tailoring treatments to an individual's cancer. These trials involving chemotherapy are based on the genomics of the patient and their tumour. The Precision Panc platform brings together expertise from the University of Glasgow, Cancer Research UK, institutes at the Beeston, Cambridge, Manchester and Cancer Research Institute in London, University of Oxford and, of course, the wider NHS. There is excellent evidence that participation in clinical trials is associated with better outcomes for patients, so there can be optimism. These types of clinical trials allow researchers across the country to share expertise and knowledge, as well as for creating and sharing of infrastructure, leading to trials which are quicker to set up and recruit for. The Precision Panc platform has a proven track record of delivering positive outcomes and research for pancreatic cancer patients. So again, there can be optimism, as Clare Adamson has already stated. There have been development of biomarkers of prognosis and response to treatment, and they have successfully identified why pancreatic cancer is resistant to some drug therapies. Current trials are the PRIMUS 001 through to PRIMUS 005, as well as the Master Protocol. Some trials are now reaching the clinical report stage scheduled for early next year. This work is vitally important. I would ask the Minister to give a commitment that the Scottish Government will continue to support it. Presiding Officer, one issue I would like to just briefly highlight on is issues facing constituents across Galloway when engaging in treatment for pancreatic and other cancers. People living in D&G, including Stranraer and Wigtonshire, despite living in one of the most remote and rural parts of Scotland, do not have access to non-means-tested travel reimbursement to and from treatment appointments outside D&G. I know the Minister is aware that I've been pursuing this, and I would ask that she continues to assist me in pursuing this for constituents. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I again congratulate Clare Adamson on bringing this debate forward, and I welcome the work which is ongoing to advance treatment of pancreatic cancer. So we can continue to be optimistic, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms. Harper. I now call final speaker in the open debate, Siobhan Brown, for 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Firstly, I'd also like to thank Clare Adamson for bringing this important debate to the Chamber and all the informed contributions to this evening. As we've heard, pancreatic cancer can be ruthless, and I recently was told a very touching story by a family who have been devastated by pancreatic cancer. They've given me permission today to share their story. Bridget was 79 when she died from pancreatic cancer, just 3 months before her 80th birthday. She was the mother of three and a grandmother to 13, and was back and forth to the doctors for two years. She was told the pain in her back was due to wear and tear, that the night sweats were her age, that indigestion was a hiatus hernia, the weight loss was her diabetes, and that her low mood was because she was depressed due to caring for her husband. But when a new doctor joined the practice, she was sent for an ultrasound, which detected black lesions on her liver. The consultant thought it could be secondary cancer, which had spread from somewhere else, and Bridget was referred for an MRI scan. That never happened. Shortly afterwards, she was rushed to hospital, screaming in uncontrollable pain. She was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, and it spread to her liver and lungs. She died at home 40 days after the diagnosis. Tragically, 17 hours after Bridget died, her husband Dick passed away. The family said of a broken heart, watching his wife of 40 years suffer to this cruel disease. That was 7 years ago, but for Bridget's family, the heartache continues daily. So have we made progress since 2014? Well, we've heard from my colleagues today that the facts and figures surrounding pancreatic cancer, the most shocking of which, it has a lower survival rate and of any of the most common cancers. And if Bridget's story tells us anything, it's that early detection is key and that knowing the science is just as important. Pancreatic Cancer UK report, 2/3 of people in the UK cannot name a single symptom of the disease, and we need to change that. But could you spot them? Thanks to the earlier speakers today, we have heard of some of the symptoms, but it's important to reiterate them again. Back pain, stomach pain, weight loss, yellowing of skin or eyes. And then there's one that Bridget had, such as hot flushes, the shivers and indigestion. And thanks also goes to people like Gavin Oates, a Troon-born author and comedian. Last year he was asked by Pancreatic Cancer Action Scotland to share the story of his father, who died from the disease. Gavin set out to spread awareness of the symptoms and to encourage people to seek out a diagnosis. His father, Eric, died at just 65. He was given 6 months to live, but he fought bravely for 16 months. His symptoms presented as indigestion. And the message that keeps being repeated today is that early diagnosis is key. Under Scotland's Cancer Recovery Plan, three early diagnosis centres are being piloted across Scotland, including one at Ayr Hospital, which I visited earlier this year. Under the Ayrshire and Arran Health Board, the centre is dedicated to early diagnosis, aiming to get patients tested and, if required, referred to a specialist in 21 days. This is life-saving and will help to pick up cancer earlier if patients don't meet referral guidelines, non-specific symptoms like Bridget's weight loss and fatigue. We're getting better, but we have a long way to go. Let's look at Australia. Although Australia has one of the highest cancer rates in the world, it also has one of the lowest mortality rates of cancer. Why is this? Well, according to the World Economic Forum, the answer is sound policy and planning. Every country needs a cancer control plan, which is monitored by data and aims to treat and prevent cancer. As I close, Presiding Officer, we need to continue to raise awareness of the signs of this cruel disease. We owe it to the people like Bridget and their families. And the message again is, know the signs, the symptoms, visit your doctor, trust your instincts. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Brown. I now call Marie Todd to respond to the debate. Minister, for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I want to thank Clare Adamson for raising this motion in the Chamber today and for all of my colleagues' powerful and often personal contributions. It's wonderful to hear that John Scott is doing well, and it's great to see so many members actively engaged in this debate, which has given us an opportunity to reflect on the work that we've achieved and what further work there is still to do. There are a few points which were raised that I would like to touch upon before we close off this debate. But before doing that, I want to make sure that the members know that the Scottish Government buildings will be lit up to raise awareness tomorrow evening on 18th November on World Pancreatic Cancer Day. Raising awareness of pancreatic cancer and its common symptoms, back pain, yellowing skin, indigestion, tummy pain and weight loss is absolutely crucial in detecting this cancer early. And we know that the earlier that cancer is detected, the easier it is to treat. And that's why we continue to invest in our £44 million Detect Cancer Early programme, with an additional £20 million committed over the parliamentary term. We know that over the pandemic, our urgent suspicion of cancer referral rates fell below pre-COVID levels. In order to increase uptake, public awareness campaigns and messaging have run throughout the pandemic to encourage those with possible cancer symptoms to seek help. And I'm pleased to say that our urgent referral rates are now above pre-COVID levels. I would absolutely encourage any individual who might be experiencing common symptoms of cancer to present to their GP. And I want to let the Chamber know that we'll have a national awareness campaign on the NHS being open, running from December this year, including a national door drop. Unfortunately, pancreatic cancer continues to be one of the less survivable cancers. Pancreatic Cancer UK have stated that only one in four people diagnosed with pancreatic cancer survive beyond a year. And the five-year survival rate is even fewer, with only 5.6% surviving in Scotland, compared to the average five-year survival rate of 69% for other more survivable cancers. And it's for these reasons that we have focused on improving outcomes for the less survivable cancers in our National Cancer Plan. The Scottish Government works closely with a number of partners to raise awareness of pancreatic cancer and to improve their outcomes after diagnosis. Pancreatic Cancer UK is a key partner alongside the Less Survivable Cancer Task Force in continuing to push forward work streams and to improve cancer outcomes. And we know that over the course of the pandemic, the need for further support of patients was amplified, with third sector organisations like Pancreatic Cancer UK seeing a significant increase in helpline calls, with a peak of 50% increase. And I want to thank our third sector partners for their continued work and support of cancer patients. In addition, we're working with the Scottish Hepatopancreatobiliary Network, SHPBN, I'll just use the acronym next time, to improve pathways across pancreatic and liver cancers. And we've provided £653,000 of funding to that network over two financial years to redesign these cancer pathways. And that work is aimed to improve patient outcomes and experiences. Now, we know that patients with a cancer diagnosis and those around them, as we've heard so powerfully in the chamber this evening, can be impacted mentally as well as physically from a diagnosis and subsequent treatment. And the work of SHPBN is looking at investigative and diagnosis stage of the pathway. But in order to improve the pathway, there'll be a new navigation team which will help improve communications within the health service and directly with patients. And that work is one step we're taking to increase the support offered to patients. And I hope that responds to the points raised by Dr. Gulhani. Alongside this work, the National Cancer Plan outlines the development of the single point of contact and our transforming cancer care partnerships with Macmillan's support. A single point of contact will help to ensure patients are being supported in all clinical aspects, including mental health, along their cancer journey. And we recently awarded funding to 12 pilot programmes which are based across the three cancer networks. And the Scottish Government's partnership with Macmillan will ensure that every cancer patient in Scotland has access to a specialist key worker who can provide emotional, financial and practical support to those who need it most. Further to providing patients with support, we must focus on the best available treatment, and many members will be aware of the pancreatic enzyme replacement therapy, PERT. Now, this therapy is a capsule taken that replaces the enzymes that your pancreas would normally make, and if you have pancreatic cancer, taking pancreatic enzymes can help you to digest your food. But, as has been mentioned, not all patients are offered PERT at the point of diagnosis, and that's for a variety of reasons. These reasons could be legitimate, so perhaps the patient's on a palliative care pathway or cultural preference, but equally, Many pancreatic cancer patients present as asymptomatic despite pancreatic exocrine insufficiency. And lastly, patients are diagnosed through lots of different pathways, so not all clinicians have the knowledge and experience to know about the importance of PERT. On the use of stereotactic ablative radiotherapy, as raised by Clare Adamson, I'm pleased to inform the Chamber that there was a project funded in the most recent funding round, so up to £1.6 million over 2 years has been committed, and we're taking a once-for-Scotland approach to roll out this treatment across Scotland. The Precision PAN research, which was highlighted by a number of contributors, including Emma Harper, is led by a team at Glasgow University and is indeed absolutely world-leading. And research into precision medicine remains a high priority for the Scottish Government. In order to inform best practice, the Scottish Government continues to learn from the best available evidence. And as members have highlighted, the Scottish Cancer Patient Experience Survey, run in partnership with Macmillan Cancer Support, has a survivability bias. So that survey is designed to be comparable with cancer patient experience surveys run in England and Wales, and a change in methodology such as altering the sample population, certainly.
Clare Adamson.
Thank you very much, Minister, for taking the intervention. Just on the survey, I wonder if the Minister would have a look at the timescales in which the survey is actually delivered, because as we've heard about the difficulties around pancreatic cancer, very often their patients have passed away in the timescale in which that's delivered, and I wonder if that's something she could reflect on.
Minister.
Absolutely, I'm very keen to take that point on board. In order to capture the experience of patients with less survivable cancer, we are using tools such as Care Opinion and working with our third sector partners to collate the best evidence available, but I'm happy to get back to Clare Adamson with any further evidence that we have on that particular issue. Members may be aware that NHS England's announced a new national pancreatic cancer audit, which NHS Wales are partnering with. Unfortunately, in Scotland, our partners in the Scottish HPB network have completed audits annually since 2010. The 2013-19 audits are based on quality performance indicators, including some specific to pancreatic cancer. And those annual audit reports are available on the SHPBN website. The 2020 audit is currently in progress. So, as we've heard here this evening, the Scottish Government, along with all of us here, are absolutely committed to increasing awareness of pancreatic cancer and improving cancer patients' experiences and outcomes. I want to thank all of our partners who help us in achieving these goals, from the clinicians working in the NHS to our third sector partners that have been tirelessly supporting patients. Together, we can improve and achieve our ambitions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.